As we have mentioned previously, seasons are one of the most misunderstood physical geography concepts. Notably, many people incorrectly believe that the seasons are caused by the varying distance between the sun and the earth. Folks think that summer is when earth is closer to the sun, and winter is when earth is farther from the sun. This is false. Study the figure here to verify this and to review the terms aphelion and perihelion. Consider pausing the video. So what causes the seasons? Well, during the year, the sun angles and day lengths change due to the changing relationship between the earth and the sun. These changes result from a combination of four factors: the earth's revolution around the sun, the earth's rotation on its axis, the constant tilt angle of 23.5 degrees of the Earth's axis relative to the plane of the ecliptic, and the polarity of the Earth's axis. Throughout the year, the Earth's axis is always parallel to its position at other locations. It essentially always points towards the North Star. If any of these four factors were different, our seasons would be much different, or in some cases, they would be absent. For example, if the Earth's axis was not tilted, but was rather perpendicular to the plane of the ecliptic, then the direct rays of the sun would always hit the equator, as shown here. And the angle of the incoming sun would be constant throughout the year for every location on Earth. Different locations on Earth would get different intensities of sunlight, but it would not change throughout the year at each location. So, no seasons. Instead, because of the Earth's revolution, rotation, inclination, and polarity, the Earth's annual path around the sun looks like this. Notice that the most direct rays from the sun, those that are coming in at 90 degrees, hit at different latitudes at different times of the year. You can see that in our northern hemisphere winter time, the direct rays of the sun hit in the southern hemisphere. Later, in our northern hemisphere summertime, the direct rays hit in the northern hemisphere. So the tilt of the Earth's axis and the fact that the axis remains parallel to itself throughout the revolution really makes a difference. It ends up that different latitudes get the direct rays of the sun at different times of the year. Notice this term, insolation. It's actually an acronym for incoming solar radiation. So I may use this throughout the course. Insolation simply means the incoming solar radiation from the sun. The point on the Earth that gets the 90 degree direct rays of the sun is called the subsolar point. And as noted in this diagram, the subsolar point migrates north and south between the Tropic of Cancer and the Tropic of Capricorn, and then back up to the Tropic of Cancer, back down to the Tropic of Capricorn throughout the year. So the Tropic of Cancer and the Tropic of Capricorn each have one day of the year where they get the direct rays of the sun. And everywhere in between the two tropics actually get the direct rays of the sun twice a year. Once as the point migrates up and once as the point migrates down. Regions on Earth outside of the tropics never get the direct rays of the sun. Let's follow the path of the sun one more time. June 21st, it's at the Tropic of Cancer, then July, August, September, October, November, December, January, February, March, April, May, June. Back and forth. And the Tropic of Cancer and the Tropic of Capricorn, that's why we have these special points, and that's why they were some of the important parallels that I had you remember. It's the northernmost and southernmost limit of the direct rays of the sun. We can see the same thing on this diagram. The direct rays of the sun hitting at the Tropic of Cancer on June 21st, and as the Earth revolves around, it hits at the equator here. You can't see it. It's on the other side, on the equinox. Then the direct rays are hitting in the southern hemisphere at the Tropic of Capricorn on the December solstice, and then back again at the equinox on the or excuse me, at the equator on the equinox in March, and then back in the northern hemisphere at the Tropic of Cancer on June 21st. So those special days of the year, when the sun's direct rays hit as far north as they'll ever go, the Tropic of Cancer, or as far south as they'll ever go, the Tropic of Capricorn, those special days are called the solstices, the June and December solstice. On the June solstice, the northern hemisphere is tilted towards the sun, and on the December solstice, the southern hemisphere is tilted towards the sun, or you could think of it as the northern hemisphere being tilted away from the sun. So over here, when the northern hemisphere is tilted away from the sun, this is northern hemisphere winter. When the northern hemisphere is tilted towards the sun, this is northern hemisphere summer. For clarity, we should not refer to these two dates as the summer and winter solstice, however, because what is summer in the northern hemisphere is winter in the southern hemisphere. So to be clear, we'll just call them the June and December solstices. For each of the solstices, you should be able to tell which hemisphere is tilted towards the sun. And you should also be able to note the latitude of the direct rays of the sun. Just as another way of saying the location of the subsolar point for each solstice. Additionally, you should also be able to tell where the edge of the circle of illumination is on these two special days. Remember that at all times, half of the Earth is in the sun, and half is in the dark. The circle of illumination shows us where the sun's rays hit at just one point. In geometry, we would call these the tangent rays. Right here, and right here. It's the edge of the sunlight. So notice on the June solstice that these tangent rays hit at the Arctic Circle and the Antarctic Circle. This marks the edge of the circle of illumination. Aha! This is why we label these as important parallels. They mark the edge of the sunlight on the solstices. Notably, since half of the Earth is always within the circle of illumination, we can calculate where these edges would be. The vertical rays mark the center, and on the June solstice, we know that those vertical rays strike at the Tropic of Cancer. Half of the Earth is in the sunlight. Half of the Earth would be 180 degrees. So we can just go up 90 degrees and down 90 degrees from those vertical rays to equal the full 180 degrees that's in the sunlight. So to find these tangent rays, or the edge of the circle of illumination, just go up 90 and down 90 from the direct vertical rays. All right, let's do it. From the Tropic of Cancer, which is 23.5 degrees north, we move down to the equator, that's 23.5 degrees, but we still need to go another 66.5 degrees to add up to a total of 90. So if we go another 66.5 degrees south, we end up at the Antarctic Circle. Next, let's do the same thing going north. From the subsolar point at 23.5 degrees, we go up to the pole. That's 66.5 degrees. But in order to get to 90, we need another 23.5 degrees down the other side. 90 minus 23.5 degrees gets us at 66.5 degrees on the other side of the pole, or the other side of the Arctic Circle. So the edge of the circle of illumination, or where these tangent rays strike, is at 66.5 degrees north and 66.5 degrees south. Those values will always be the same. One, though, will be on the near side of a pole, and one will be on the far side of a pole. So you can check your work by making sure that the values end up being the same. This is interesting. Check out the Arctic Circle. The entire Arctic Circle is within the circle of illumination as the Earth rotates on its axis. So as the Earth rotates, everywhere north of the Arctic Circle will always be in the sunlight. They will have 24 hours of daylight. It doesn't ever get dark at this time of year north of the Arctic Circle. Cool, but what happens down here? South of the Antarctic Circle. Everywhere 66.5 degrees and further south is in the darkness. So as the Earth turns on its axis, This area never sees daylight. They have 24 hours of darkness during this time of the year. Yikes! Next, check out the equator. Exactly half of it is in the circle of illumination. That means they'll have 12-hour days and 12-hour nights as the Earth turns on its axis. Notice as you go north of the equator, a larger and larger percentage of each parallel is within the circle of illumination. So as you go north from the equator in June, you'll have longer and longer day lengths. Similarly, as you go south from the equator, you see a smaller percentage of each parallel is within the circle of illumination. So you'd have shorter and shorter day lengths as you proceed south. You should do a similar analysis now for the December solstice. You should figure out where the direct rays hit and where the tangent rays hit. That means where is the edge of the circle of illumination. You should also figure out what latitudes would get 24 hours of light and which latitudes would get 24 hours of darkness. Where the daylight is exactly 12 hours, and where it is more, and where it is less. Consider stopping the video now and figuring all that out. Also, I highly encourage you to draw a simple diagram. Your diagram does not have to be fancy. Check this out. I've just drawn a circle for the Earth, sort of, drawn the sun, drawn some direct rays coming in, and some rays that are just barely hitting the Earth at the tangent points here. The edge of the circle of illumination. So first of all, this is the June solstice. I know that the direct rays hit at the Tropic of Cancer. So the Earth is tilted northern hemisphere towards the sun. So I'm going to draw the equator like that. That's our equator. 0 degrees. Right here is the Tropic of Cancer. 23.5 degrees north. This is easier to do on a piece of paper, right? You can draw the Tropic of Capricorn right down there. And then the edge of the circle of illumination, right, we know is at the Arctic Circle. Here's the pole. Down here is the South Pole. And here's our Antarctic Circle right there. So this would be a nice drawing of what's going on during the June solstice. The other thing you might want to do is just connect this down here. And you could even shade in. I should have done this with a whoopsie. You could even shade in the dark part of the Earth. Let's get rid of that. But you get the idea. Anyway, pause the video, make a nice diagram of the June solstice and December solstice in your notes.